Good afternoon. This is the first London lunch break of what from October may become a regular monthly series. It's transmitted live over Channel 7. That's the ILEA's higher education network in London. The entire production is organised by STOIC, that's the student television of Imperial College. London Lunch Break will be a news magazine programme, not competing with national television, but rather exploiting the local interest value of higher education in London. In this first edition, we have several London Students' Union presidents talking on the issues of the day. We also have news of the new travel service, a roundup of what's on in London, and we especially welcome Barry Norman of BBC Television's Film 77. So firstly, Mike Williams.
Thank you, James. With us in the studio are the union presidents of four London colleges to discuss with me the role of student unions. The four presidents are Maurice Vallely of the Royal College of Art, Phil Hawler of Queen Elizabeth College, John Edmondson of Bedford College, and Marcus Taylor of Queen Mary College. I'd like to start, if I may, by asking the simple question, what is the role of a student union? Phil.
Well, it states in the Constitution that we're a social body. We're meant to represent the students, sort of sporting activities generally, and also, particularly in recent view of the increase in the cuts and this sort of thing, as a sort of politically campaigning body. To a lot of people in the college, the latter one sort of often appears to be of minor importance, but particularly amongst the executive and people like this, it's
do you feel that the students at grassroots level don't seem to identify with the politics of some of the unions?
I think it's often due to the fact that it's very difficult for us to put over the arguments. They sort of tend to become very complacent about it. They can't really relate to it unless they actually things do affect them directly.
Certainly I think one could possibly expect a lot of a lot more political awareness in light of the education cuts that are going to be happening. How do you think you'll be able to cope with education cuts? Is there going to be a big campaign in your college?
It depends very much on how the cuts are presented in the college, the motions which go to general union meetings. But in fact there is a sort of groundswell growing, especially on the fees increases for overseas students generally, and quite wide knowledge of how the college is actually beginning to restructure itself under the impact of the cuts.
I'd like to ask, do you think that political awareness, basically, amongst students is on the increase? John?
Yes, slowly, because the cuts are getting to affect more and more students, and students are starting to take an interest in why these cuts are affecting them, and out of necessity, they are being forced to become more aware.
Right. Marcus, I'd like to ask you how student unions are financed, how they get their money, and how this will be affected, if at all, by education cuts?
Well, as far as the university colleges are concerned, at the moment, we're not affected at all in our financing. Under various statutory instruments and acts of parliament, student union financing, direct from the local education authorities in the main, is secure. The thing I find disturbing in this way is the recent move by Collegiate Council to take all other parts of what used to be termed composition fee in with the tuition area and to leave student union fee as a bit on top. It seems to me that in the next couple of years, that bit on top, in QMC's case for next year, £20 per head, looks likely and as an easy target to be taken out. If LEAs decide that they want to cut back.
I see. If we could move on to how student unions actually work. Now, you are four presidents, and all four of you are sabbatical. Now, were you all elected by college-wide ballot, or was it done at a union meeting, or what? Was it all done college-wide ballot?
College-wide ballot, yes.
Now, you do have union general meetings, and I know that that is often a focus for student apathy by kind of absence. Do you have trouble getting quorate union meetings at your college, Phil?
Generally, no. We sometimes find at the beginning of terms that there's a particularly low number of people turn out. Whether or not the publicity could perhaps be better on our part, I don't know. It's they're generally well attended. Our quorate number is 10%, which represents somewhere about 95 students in a college of 1,000. We generally get about 110, 115 people in, but it sort of fluctuates around that area. If it's something of specific interest, which, if you like, gets people's backs up, or if they really feel it affects
something
them,
something controversial.
Then we'll normally get a very good turnout.
What about at the Royal College of Art, Morris?
The quorum is extraordinarily high there. It's 90 out of a total of 612 students. This again depends very much on the sort of groundwork which the union does, the opinion by which the union executive are held by the students themselves. Once again, it depends very much on the issue which is being raised. We tend to get very big quorums for issues which are internal to the students' union itself, how it operates.
What about external issues? Things on political issues outside the country, even?
Generally speaking, most of the students there, and you know, it's not of major importance to them. It has to directly affect the students in one way or another.
I see. Can I talk about facilities? Is it generally true that the amount of facilities that a college has usually depends on the number of students actually at that college? So the larger the college, the better the facilities. Is that true, John, at Bedford?
More or less, but Bedford is unfortunately in a royal park and has restrictions on what it can do. And in that respect, it isn't a typical London college.
I see. I know at Queen Mary College, they tend to be fairly self-sufficient, whereas some of the smaller colleges, like the Royal College of Art, possibly not quite so self-sufficient with their facilities. Is that true?
Yes, I would think so. But then again, QMC is a little bit special in its geographical location. It is 2 or 3 miles away from the centre. Over the last 10 or 15 years, it has expanded quite considerably. Our union sports facilities have increased with that expansion. The necessity for the facilities of ULU for QMC students is not as high as it would be for possibly other colleges.
I see. I'd like to talk about the University of London Union. Now, each college has its own student union, and there is this thing, ULU, the University of London Union. How do students actually relate to that? Because I remember myself as a fresher, being at a fairly large college, I didn't really have much recourse to go to ULU or even know what it really was all about. Do you find that at your college, Phil?
Well, being a small college, our facilities are somewhat limited, particularly sporting and social. We haven't got sort of large areas to hold functions. The University of London serves directly in that respect as a sort of sporting facility. I mean, there's the gymnasiums, etc. It's also got its other functions, the Student Representative Council, which, in fact, we send a high attendance of people along to. It's generally 3 people at every meeting. And we bring back policies either from Student Representative Council to the college, or it has happened occasionally that we've taken policy from our college to the Student Representative Council. But the people in our college relate to the University of London Union as a sort of sporting facility, the swimming pool and that sort of thing.
Do you think that ULU has a worthwhile function to serve, Morris?
I don't think many of our students actually use ULU at all, actually. We tend to be very self-sufficient down at our place, in the sense that the facilities are fairly good. The constitution states that anyone who gets 11 signatures can set a society, and they tend to do that. They tend to do that very well, actually. ULU is usually used for attendance at meetings. I mean, but Imperial College tends to be a focus for facilities, which our students sort of wander over to now and again.
John, do you think that maybe ULU is a bit of a white elephant?
No, I don't think so. I think it brings together the students from the different colleges. It's a meeting ground which offers exchange of ideas, exchange of facilities. And I think that in this it is an important body. And also, of course, it is recognised by the University of London Senate as the main voice of the university students, and in this place an important part.
Finally, I'd like to get on to the subject of the NUS. We've heard about the travel being sold. We've heard about it being in financial difficulties. What future do you think there is for the NUS, and what kind of part do you think your college is going to play in it? Morris.
Well, there have been a large number of recent wave of disaffiliation motions that have gone through NUS. I think basically the big difficulty with NUS is that it has in the past presented itself as a union which provides facilities, usually social facilities or services. Was in fact that this tended to play down the campaigning nature of the union. I think in in the future, in the present period, is going to have to concentrate much more on campaigning, because in our college there's been rumblings, you know, what does NUS do? Mm. Is it any use? I think it has to present itself. It must have a much more forward image than it has had in the past.
Phil, what do you think of NUS?
I can second that. It's the image of being a campaigning union has been played down by the services. Now with the services, if you like, being stripped away, perhaps we can see NUS in its true light, which should be an effective political campaigning union. It is, if you like, the ultimate body for negotiations between the students and Great Britain as a whole, technical colleges, FEs, polytechnics, universities, university colleges such as the ones in London, and it should, in that respect, be a campaigning union.
John?
Well, there's been talk of, by some political parties, of abolishing NUS, but I think if they did, another one would rise, because students do need this campaigning body. There is concern at Bedford at the moment that perhaps too much of its income is spent on wages, but we all agree that we need a national voice.
Marcus?
I think a national conference in December, the ideas that have been put forward here of a campaigning union were certainly sold to the delegates there. I'm less sure whether the campaigning union will be sold in general to students. The people who were at national conference with those of us who were and are committed to a national union, the general student, to use a phrase I don't particularly like, but the student who's not involved, I think look very much upon NUS for the services that it provided. And I feel from my own college a certain amount of dissatisfaction now that those services have been reduced.
Well, gentlemen, thank you. That's food for thought. James.
My mistake.
We now go over to Steve Burgess for the London What's On.
And thank you, Mike Williams. In this spot, we'll be taking a brief look at some of the general events of interest for students taking place over the next few days in London colleges. Firstly, today, Wednesday, the Queen Elizabeth College Film Society are showing the film Bonnie and Clyde, which stars Warren Beatty and Faye Dunaway. And this is being shown in the Allen Theatre and starts at 7 o'clock. Admission is 25 pence, but you need your student union cards to get in. Also today, Imperial College Folk Club have a singer's night at Selkirk Hall from 8 p.m. onwards, and admission to that is free. Coming on to tomorrow, Imperial College Entertainments Committee will be showing the film Brannigan, which stars John Wayne. The film can be seen in the Mechanical Engineering Department. The film starts at 6:30 and the admission is 15 pence. Turning to Friday, the Simon Townsend Rock Band are playing at Queen Elizabeth College at 7:30 p.m. and admission is 30 pence. Also on Friday, there's the Chelsea College Disco, which takes place between 8 p.m. and 11 p.m. and admission to that is 15 pence. Still on Friday at 7:30 p.m, Queen Mary College present George Milley with John Chilton and the Seat Warmers, with tickets on the door at 1:50. On Friday, there's also the University College Beer Festival between noon and 2:30 and 6 p.m. and 12 midnight. Admission is £1.10 and includes 3 pints of beer. Finally, on Sunday, Chelsea College are showing the film The Rat Race. Admission to this is 15 pence and the film starts at 7 o'clock. Also on Sunday, Queen Elizabeth College are putting on their usual Sunday disco, which begins at 8 p.m. And the admission to that is 20 pence. And once again, student union cards are required for that. And that concludes our brief What's On Spot. Well, we've already heard of some of the gigs during the week, so courtesy of RCA Records, here's some music from Daryl Hall and John Oakes as they sing Rich Girl. I understand we're having a bit of technical trouble here, so we're back with the union presidents to continue our talk about the NUS. What I'd like to further this discussion with is about the politics of the NUS and how they've changed over the past, say, 10 years. It used to be fairly right-wing, almost, controlled by the Tories until about 69, and then there came Jack Straw to the presidency, and there seemed to be a whole shift to the left wing. Now, it's been argued that that wasn't necessarily reflected
amongst the students, that it's gone to the left and people are trying to drag students to the left, but they're not necessarily prepared to go that far. What do you think of that, John?
Well, I certainly think that the extremists have shouted loudest, but I do think it's true that students as a whole have moved slightly to the left, perhaps not as often or as much as the media would like to make out. And I think the average student, again a horrible term, is greatly abused by the actions of the extremists.
What kind of role do you think the media has played in this? Because it wasn't long ago that we were talking to Bruce Kemble at Imperial College on the role of the media about students in general. And we suggested to him that the Daily Express had been pretty nasty to students in the past. We're not here to libel or to slander, but what do you think about that briefly?
I think the media has been particularly bad and unfair to students. It's been unfair in the sense of its natural function, I suppose, is to put on things that will sell newspapers, that will get people to watch the television. It has, therefore, picked on areas of minorities of students doing things of a newsworthy value, rather than the hundreds of thousands of students who are doing things that may be a damn sight more useful, but may not hit the headlines. And I think in that, students have been maligned by the media.
Do you think that students really have been maligned by the media, Morris?
Very difficult to say. For example, the expulsion at the last NUS conference, I forget the name,
Sir Keith Joseph,
was really picked up, and it was lauded in the media.
But then again, isn't that the kind of thing that should be picked up? I mean, if they are going to take such a, I don't know, it struck me as a very obstreperous attitude to Sir Keith Joseph. I mean, he's only some guy, that, for what he represents, maybe they should have thrown him out. But to actually do that, I thought they would have had more sense.
Yes, but what I was actually going to say is that NUS does actually do a lot of canvassing and gathering of information, which and does provide an extremely good service for information for students on questions of education, in college constitutions and so on, which are extremely useful for furthering the aims of student unions, which is extremely important work. The media doesn't pick this up. It tends to pick up, I agree with what you said, that the media picks up things which are of news value or sensational.
Can we talk about NUS conference now? The NUS executive, as we know at the moment, are elected at an NUS conference, the annual conference. There are moves, we all know, to democratise it, I think the word is, by having a national ballot where every member of NUS can take part in the ballot as opposed to just delegates. Do you think that that is ever going to happen?
No. And I wouldn't want it to happen.
Why not?
Because I think that many students would therefore just put a cross against perhaps a party name that means a little more to them without knowing about anything about the individuals. And the NUS exec is, although it follows a party line, is made up of individuals. And the students have ample chance to vote because they may go to their general meetings and mandate their delegates to vote in the appropriate fashion.
Well, thank you very much, gentlemen, for helping us to fill in. I understand the technical troubles have been solved now, so it's over to Steve Burgess.
And as you'll remember from the What's On Spot, there are many gigs on during the week, so courtesy of RCA Records, let's try once again to hear from Daryl Hall and John Oates singing a number called Rich Girl.
You're a rich girl, and you're gone too far, cause you know it don't matter anyway. You can rely on the old man's money, you can rely on the old man's money, it's a bitch girl, and it's gone too far, cause you know it don't matter anyway. Say money, money won't get you too far, get you too far. And don't you know, and don't you know, that it's wrong, whoa. So take what is given you, so far gone, on your own. You can get along if you try to be strong, but you'll never be strong.
Too far, get you too far.
Now, as many of you will know, last term, NUS Travel went bust with debts in excess of £900,000. And two gentlemen who are trying to start a new London student travel service are Trevor Phillips, here, who's Vice President of NUS and Secretary of the London Students Organisation, and Nick Brayshaw, who's President of Imperial College Union. Firstly, Nick, can you explain basically the motivation for a new travel service?
Well, when NUS Travel collapsed on the 19th of November, although it went out with debts, as you say, very, very high debts, there was, in fact, a lot of people still using the service, and it had, we feel, a role to play in the student unions and to the students themselves. What we did try and do immediately following the collapse was to investigate whether this demand for a student travel service and for the service it could provide could be harnessed in the London area.
Can you basically explain what the new travel service will sell? Will it be the same sort of thing as NUS Travel?
The first fundamental difference is that NUS Travel was an operator. Mm-hmm. We won't be an operator, we will be selling other people's travel.
I see. Tell me, how's it going to be organised? I mean, are you going onto the market now as a limited liability company, or...?
We are in the process at the moment of setting up a limited liability company, the shares for which can be bought by the student unions. This means that when the company is on the air, or when the company is on the go, sorry, that...
yes?
When the company is on the go, it means it will be fully owned by student unions. We'll be selling other people's travel, and we will have managers to run the people to run the service for us.
Trevor, can you explain why it should be any more viable than NUS Travel is at the minute?
Well, there are three big reasons. One is that London is now the travel centre, student travel centre, not just of Britain but of Europe. Mm-hmm. Secondly, the new company will be a travel broker rather than a travel operator. Therefore, what we will be able to do is to select the best and cheapest, most competitive products at any one time and sell those. And thirdly, because we're not an operator and don't have the vast overheads of a typical travel operator, then we'll be able to have much greater flexibility and be able to switch in and out of products as the market demands.
Aren't there already a large number of student travel organisations in existence anyway, specifically Transalpino?
Well, Transalpino, remember, is a train service.
Yes.
It offers a fairly limited range of products, and Transalpino is an operator rather than a broker. And in that sense, were we, for instance, to be marketing Transalpino's product, we would not be in conflict. The other point that I should make is that a student-controlled travel service, if it's a broker, has the greatest advantage of any travel agent, and that is access to the student market.
Whilst we're talking about NUS Travel and things similar to it, can you briefly tell us how much of that £900,000 that NUS Travel went into debt will be suffered by the NUS itself, and hence by the college unions?
I couldn't say that for certain until the liquidator has completed his work. Mm-hmm. We know that something in excess of 60,000.
What I'm basically asking is how much do we have to pay? I mean, how much is coming from us?
From
students in their fees?
Ultimately nothing, in fact. As you'll know, we've sold Ensley, the insurance company, which was in fact not paid up by subscription income. We sold Ensley, and it's hoped that the income from the sale of Ensley will in fact cover all the debts that exist as a result of accruing to NUS itself as a result of the crash.
Nick, specifically, didn't Imperial College Union once have a travel service of its own?
It used to have its own local student travel bureau,
yes,
as they are called, up to, I think, 1973, when NUS Travel Service became NUS Travel Limited. And then we were persuaded and cajoled to turning our office, which was a commercial concern, into an office for the National Union of Students.
OK, Trevor, let's turn to something slightly different and broaden the issue slightly, because some people will say that this is just trying to save face for NUS. Because if you ask somebody, why are you a member of NUS, the response very often used to be because of their travel service, because of the NUS services. Now there are barely any NUS services left. Haven't you got something to answer for?
No, I'd refer back to the earlier remarks that particularly Maurice Vallely from RCA made, mm-hmm, and that is that NUS's fundamental role and its great strength is its campaigning strength. I personally think that service provision is a part of any union's role, and that's why I'm endeavouring to try to make sure that there's a service for London students, because that's part of my job as somebody concerned with London students specifically.
Specifically, what NUS services are left?
Well, they're still the marketing company. We sold Endsley, but we still maintain a degree of interest mm-hmm. in the insurance company. We've now mounted the discount card, of course, which is probably the most direct and possibly relevant service that NUS offers to students will be maintained, because it's not part of a company, it's part of NUS itself.
Of course, a lot of college unions are beginning to have a long, hard look at NUS in principle, Imperial College Union amongst them. Do you think, you must admit, this must be to some extent justified now?
Well, I think it's always justified. I'm one of those who's in favour, where it's necessary, of actually debating the question of affiliation each year. But I think you should be aware that something like 30 unions may have debated disaffiliation over the last year, and only two, as far as I'm aware, have decided to disaffiliate, and that decision may well be overturned before the end of the year.
So how many major unions in the country are there who aren't members of NUS still?
Glasgow University, as I recall.
That's
and St Andrews. And St Andrews
okay,
University.
Okay, finally, Trevor, 3 years ago you were president of Imperial College Union. Last year you were president of University of London Union, and you danced with the Queen Mother at the Yulu Ball. You're now vice president of NUS, you're sabbatical secretary of the LSO. Next year you're on the cards to be secretary of NUS. Tell me, with all these college union elections coming up, have you got any sound advice to give any candidates who are aspiring to the same dizzy heights that you've attained?
Well, as I said to you, James, the first thing that anybody's got to do is listen to the students, know where they're at, and be cool.
Be cool. Fine advice. Thank you both very much indeed. Now, Steve Burgess has a film review.
Oh, thank you, James. Well, not quite a film review. Anyway, 2 years ago on Stoic, we talked to film director Mel Brooks about what was then his latest film, Young Frankenstein. Made in black and white, it starred Marty Feldman and Gene Wilder, and managed to combine beautifully the storyline of the original Frankenstein films with the humour of the 70s. In this clip, we see arguably the funniest scene in the film, in which the monster meets the little girl in the woods.
Oh, I love my pretty little flower. Oh, I love my pretty little flower. Oh, I love my flower.
When monsters is loose, boards must be tight. Thank God you put Helga to bed. With all this monster business, I take no chances. I remember the last time.
But, Papa, I told you that I was turning the roast brown. Don't you remember? I asked you to put Helga to...
Now throw a kiss and say bye-bye.
Oh, dear, nothing left. What shall we throw in now?
Maybe she was in the bathroom when you looked.
But I didn't look upstairs. I thought you did.
You didn't look upstairs?
Sit down. Sit down.
Mel Brooks's latest film, Silent Movie, in which he also stars, is currently showing at the Odeon Haymarket and the Odeon Kensington. The film is just what the title says it is. It's a widescreen colour production, but without a dialogue. Mel Fun, Marty Eggs and Don Bell, respectively Mel Brooks, Marty Feldman and Don DeRice, play the parts of three failed filmmakers who are attempting to make a comeback. They sell their idea for a 1976 silent movie to a bankrupt studio which needs a successful film to save it from the clutches of Devour and Engulf Incorporated. The movie is to star five of today's big film stars, and in this clip we see our trio approaching the home of Burt Reynolds.
Thank you.
Solid movie, though. Our special guest today is someone who is well known to most of us, especially those who enjoy films and enjoy them being seeing them reviewed with satirical bite. He is, of course, Barry Norman. Welcome, Barry. I'd like to start, if I may, by going back to... you left Highgate School and went straight into regional journalism. Then I understand you didn't find that particularly rewarding, so you went to Africa. Now, why was that?
Oh, well, it's simply that I went to work on a weekly paper in Kensington, where I earned, it's a long time ago, I earned about £3.05 a week. It's ridiculous, isn't it? And because I'd only been there about a year, I couldn't get a better job anywhere else in England. But I had a friend who was working in Johannesburg, and being politically naive in those days, I thought Johannesburg would be a nice place to go to. And he put me in touch with a chain of newspapers over there, and they were offering me about £9 a week, so I went. It was as simple as that, a straight commercial transaction. Also, I think, you know, I felt it was a good idea to get away from home. Since I decided not to go to university, I thought it'd be a good idea to get away from home and live by myself for a couple of years.
It was presumably on the experience that you gained working on a newspaper in Johannesburg that you got the job with the Daily Mail.
Well, I came back after about 2.5 years. I didn't go straight to the Mail, I went to the Sketch, and the reason I went to the Sketch is a sort of boy gossip writer, because there was a girl in London that I wanted to keep in close contact with, and the only other jobs I was offered at that time were out of London. It didn't seem a good idea, so I stayed in London on the Daily Sketch. Whether that was a smart idea or not, I don't know.
You eventually ended up with the Mail and became show business editor of the Mail.
Yeah.
But then when the Sketch and the Mail merged, you found yourself redundant. How did you feel?
Insulted, actually. Insulted and very angry. And I think in retrospect that that's the best way to feel if you're redundant, because, you know, if you feel downcast and you think, my God, they've thrown me out, I can't be any good, then you probably aren't any good, and at least you won't be, you know, you've screwed it for yourself. But if on the other hand you say, my God, look what the fools have done now, they, you know, they can't tell stalk from butter, and you go out and try and prove that they couldn't tell stalk from butter, I think it helps. Mind you, it's easier if you're a freelance journalist, because, you know, a freelance journalist can get in touch with the paper and say, you know, can I come in and do some freelance subbing? But you can't go to ICI and say, can I come and do some freelance managing directing for you, because they don't
follow. I heard from the current features editor of The Guardian, Harry Jackson, that you did fit in with The Guardian, and you actually wrote some leaders for The Guardian, which he describes as with an unusual tone of levity. Do you remember that?
Well, I do, yes, because what happened was that when I got redundant and nobody offered me a job, so I decided I'd have to be a freelance journalist. And Bernard Levin, among other people, and quite unknown to me, wrote to people like Alastair Hetherington, who was then the editor of The Guardian, to say that, you know, if you're employing any of the redundant Daily Mail people, this one's unlikely to rape the managing director's wife or get drunk and be sick on your carpet, so he might be all right. So I went in to see Hetherington about 9:30 one night, and he, apart from what Bernard had written to him, he really didn't know anything about me, because I realised now that the big name you think you've built up on a popular paper actually doesn't mean much outside the popular paper. And he'd somehow got the idea that I was a leader writer, and I tried to disabuse him of this because I was a show business writer. And he finally said, well, look, go away, think about it for a week, come back next week and tell me if you want to write leaders for us. So I went away and I read Guardian leaders, and I thought, no, I don't, I can't write this stuff, you know, I mean, they're all terribly learned. So I came back to tell him I couldn't do leaders for him. And his secretary said, oh, Mr. Hetherington's expecting you. So I was ushered into this room where the leader writers of The Guardian were all having a conference. And they looked at me in some surprise, because they had no idea who I was or what I was doing there. Neither did I. And they all went through their proposed ideas for leaders, like, you know, the Russo-Chinese detente and the state of the economy in the Balkans and God knows what. And then finally it came to me, and Hetherington said, have you got any ideas for a leader? And all I really wanted to say was no, and can I go home, please? But I felt I couldn't do that. So I came up with some daft idea. And the others looked at me with great astonishment. It was some kind of women's lib idea based on a story that a woman in Sicily had put her husband in a chastity belt. And I went off and wrote a leader about it. It just happened like that. And for about the next 4 months, I came in 2 or 3 times a week to write leaders.
Incredible. I understand.
Incredible's the word, yeah.
I understand from your television producer that you're the odd one out of your family in terms of work in the film industry. I think, your father was Leslie Norman, who directed and produced films.
Mm-hmm.
Your mother was involved in films, your sister, your brother-in-law, your wife even. But you stayed on the kind of periphery, just reviewing them. Have you ever had any ambitions to get deeply involved with the making of a film?
Well, when I left school, what I really wanted to do then was to go into the film industry in the cutting rooms, which is really the way my father had learned. And I still think the best editors, the best directors, are the people who've come up through the cutting rooms, because they've got a kind of economy of style and line. So that's what I wanted to do, but the film industry was in one of its periodic slumps at the time. And curiously enough, journalism looked fairly healthy, and I had a certain knack of putting words together in a fairly readable way. So it was decided in a family conference that I shouldn't go in the film industry, I should go into journalism. And for about 5 years, I was sorry, in a way, because I kept wishing I was back in the movie, or I was in the movie industry. And then after a while, I decided I wasn't sorry at all, and I'm quite happy not to be involved in it.
Well, you now present Film 727 on the BBC. One often watches you as though you relish destroying a particularly bad film. Now, yeah, I mean, what gives you more pleasure, watching a good film or pulling to pieces a bad film? Or is that an unfair question?
No, perfectly fair question. I get pleasure out of watching good films. I don't actually get pleasure out of pulling down a bad film, but I do feel that if you are a critic, what is a critic? A critic really ought to be somebody who's interested in the standards of the medium which he's criticising. But I think to some extent you've got to be something of an entertainer yourself, because if you're a dull critic, nobody's going to bother listening to you. So I don't actually get pleasure out of pulling down a rotten movie. But I get a certain amount of pleasure out of writing something which I think is amusing about it.
Yeah. Do you think you have any impact on the film industry? Do you think that people really take notice?
I honestly don't know. I mean, there are certain people in Water Street who think I ought to be banned from reviewing films and hate me. But in a way, that's a compliment, because I don't feel I'm there to puff the film industry. You know, I'm the first loyalty, really, is to the viewer, who is presumably interested in finding out what a film is like before he spends his money on it. So I feel that I must be honest about the film as far as the viewer is concerned. I think some people actually go and see films on my recommendation, and sometimes they upbraid me bitterly afterwards. And other people miss films. I don't think too many people stay away from films because of me. I never advise anybody to stay away from a film, but I do often urge them to go and see a picture. But the perfect example of how little effect one can have sometimes was a film called, Confessions of a Window Cleaner, which I thought was terrible. But we always showed a good clip from any film we're reviewing. So otherwise, you've got a boring program for showing boring clips. So I did a send-up of this film, showed a very good clip. The next day, a chauffeur came to pick me up to take me off somewhere. And he said, I saw your program last night. And I said, yeah, what do you think of it? And he said, that Confessions of a Window Cleaner, that looked a good movie. So he obviously hadn't taken any notice of what I said.
I see. Well, we're slowly running out of time. I'd like to ask you finally about your other interest, which is writing novels, I understand. Mm. You've got a novel coming out next month. Can you quickly tell us what it's about?
Well, it's a modern sort of comedy about a guy who reaches the age of 35 and decides that his life is actually coming to an end, and he's a failure, he's got nowhere, he's never going to get anywhere. And it's what happens to him after that. I think it's very amusing. I hope it's amusing. It's supposed to be.
Well, we look forward to it. Barry Norman, thank you very much.
Thank you.
James.
Thank you very much. I don't think that anyone will claim that we've moved mountains this afternoon. However, television is probably the most powerful medium in the world, and a higher education network does exist in London. And hence, via London Lunch Break, it should be possible for students to gain access to this network. So we'd like ideas, we'd like suggestions, we'd like comments and profound thoughts in any form or shape. Please write to the following address. Stoic, Imperial College, London, South West 7. Or telephone the standard Imperial College number 589-5111, extension 1497. That's Stoic, Imperial College, London, South West 7. Finally, I'd like to thank everybody who helped in the production at all stages. ILEA, Channel 7, Stoic, of course, everybody who helped to create the tension and relieve it during the mistakes. And thank you very much for watching, too. This is the first live London Lunch Break, and good afternoon.